Oh, there's a river that winds on forever. I'm gonna see where it leads. Oh, there's a mountain that no man has mounted. I'm gonna stand on the peak. Out there's a land that time don't command. Wanna be the first to arrive. No time for pondering why I'm wandering on while we both survive. To the earth, would you follow me? There's a world that was meant for us.
Valley, we're so glad that you're here, and may you know the warmth and the welcome that is shared in the divine love of Christ for all creation. My name is Andrea, and I want you to know that whomever you are, wherever you're from, whomever you love, whatever you've done or maybe left undone, you're welcome at Humber Valley. For thousands of years, Indigenous people have walked these lands. Their relationship with the land is at the center of their lives and their spirituality. We're the settlers here, and we've got a lot to learn from our Indigenous siblings. We are gathered on the traditional territory of many nations, including the Haudenosaunee, the Anishinaabeg, the Mississaugas of the Credit, and the Métis. The land is home to many diverse Indigenous people. Toronto is covered by Treaty 13 with the Mississaugas of the Credit. Let's start our worship today. Sing a new song to the Lord. Let the whole earth sing to the Lord. Sing to the Lord, bless his divine name. Each day proclaim the good news that God saves. Tell everyone about the amazing love of God. For great is the Lord. Christ is worthy of our praise. Scripture reading this morning is Psalm 96. Sing to the Lord a new song. Sing to the Lord all the earth. Sing to the Lord, praise his name. Proclaim his salvation day after day. Declare his glory among the nations, his marvelous deeds among all peoples. For great is the Lord and most worthy of praise. He is to be feared above all gods, for all the gods of the nations are idols, but the Lord made the heavens. Splendor and majesty are before him, strength and glory are in his sanctuary. Ascribe to the Lord, all you families of nations. Ascribe to the Lord glory and strength. Ascribe to the Lord the glory due his name. Bring an offering and come into his courts. Worship the Lord in the splendor of his holiness. Tremble before him, all the earth. Say among the nations, the Lord reigns. The world is firmly established. It cannot be moved. He will judge the peoples with equity. Let the heavens rejoice. Let the earth be glad. Let the sea roar and all that is in it. Let the fields be jubilant and everything in them. Let all the trees of the forest sing for joy. Let all creation rejoice before the Lord, for he comes. He comes to judge the earth. He will judge the world with righteousness and the peoples with his truth.
Much deeper within, through the way things appear, you're looking into my heart. I'm coming back to the heart of worship, and it's all about you. It's all about you, Jesus. I'm sorry, Lord, for the things made it when it's all about you. Yeah, it's all about you, Jesus.
It's all about.
for a song in itself is not what you have required. 'Cause you search much deeper within, through the way things appear, you're looking into my heart. I'm coming back to the heart of worship, and it's all about you. It's all about you, Jesus. I'm sorry, Lord, for the thing I've made it. When it's all about you, it's all about you, Jesus.
Good morning, Humber Valley. Good to see you. This morning, I want to talk about film. And as we talk about film this morning, I want to be really clear from the start that it's not actually film that I want to talk about. I want to talk about worship. I'm going to talk about film in order that we can really talk about worship. Does that make sense? So I have a friend named Paula. Paula is a beautiful source for goodness and justice in this world. Long before I met Paula, she went by the name Paul and used the pronouns he, his, him. Paul was a successful minister of a large megachurch in Colorado. He was the CEO of the Orchard Group, which was like this leading multi-million-dollar church planting organization in the U.S. He had a nationally broadcast television show and was in the top tier of leaders for all things church. Paul was successful, was influential, a mover and shaker in his field. In 2012, at the age of 55, after spending her life as a closeted trans woman, Paul came out to the world as Paula. She lost all of her jobs. She was fired from her church as a pastor. She was no longer the CEO of the Orchard Group. She lost her television show. She had to navigate the complexities of coming out to her children and her grandchildren. And of course, figure, like, what does it mean to live as a trans woman who loves God in a rather conservative corner of the world? So Paula did a TED Talk a few years ago. You know what a TED Talk is? The link will be in the description below in the YouTube description. As of this week, as I checked, did this talk, Paula's talk had over 4.2 million views. She's now a best-selling author. She's the minister of Left Hand Church in Colorado and a sought-after speaker. Paula Williams is brilliant. I have another friend, equally as beautiful and equally as brilliant, named Sean. Sean makes movies. Sean has directed a number of films, and Marisol and I partnered with him on a film that we're really proud of called St. Judy. One night, Sean and I were chatting on the phone just as buddies, and I told him about my friend, Paula. And in the middle of the thought, he stopped me, and he's like, Trevor, hold on. This Paula you're telling me about, like, this is a film. The world needs to hear her story. So as soon as possible, I introduced Sean to Paula and Paula to Sean, and instantly a partnership was born. Writers were hired to write the screenplay, and the movie-making process began. And then COVID hit, and everything stopped. So I got a call this past May from Sean and his production partner, Paul, really great guy. And I could tell right away from their voices that it was going to be a conversation of consequence, right? And it was. We started talking about Paula and how great her book is and how courageous she is and what a special human being she is and how her story matters. And in many ways, Paula's story feels a bit like this treasure that we don't hold on to, but we get to hold up for the world. Like, Like, as filmmakers, it's not ours. It transcends us. It's bigger than any production company. But when seen for what it is, when we step back and think about it, Paula's story, it's a beautiful, sometimes tragic, sometimes heart-wrenching, but a beautiful, sacred story. Paula's life, experience, and journey is something sacred. The world needs more Paula, more courage, more beauty, more humanity. It's sacred. Now, still in this conversation with Sean and Paul, we started then to talk about the script and all that the writers had created. And it's a funny script because Paul is funny. It's nuanced. It's like dripping with these real and raw human moments. From the progression of character development and the beauty of being set in the Colorado Rockies, I'd say, I'm totally biased, but I'd say it's a script of substance, right? Like the screenplay of Paula's life, which is the sacred, reads in such a way that it does something in you. It does something to you. It moves you. It has the substance of a good story where it pulls you in and it changes you in some way. So in this project, there's the sacred, which is Paula's life, and there's the substance, the impact that this story is going to have. But then still on the call, my friend Sean clears his throat. He pauses for a beat and he says, "Trev, we can't make this movie." And he begins to explain how the industry is reeling with so many theaters closing down due to COVID. No one like even knows what a film should look like post-COVID. Yeah, there's Marvel and Pixar, but what does an independent drama look like now? Where's the market for that? How does that get out to the world? Who's watching that? And as he was explaining the uncertainty of the current industry, I felt this sort of like complete deflation, like all the wind had been taken out of my sails. Like the world has changed so much. And I'm sitting there and it's like, there's nothing I can do about it. We have this beautiful, hopeful, sacred story to tell with all of its potential and redemption and hope. All the impact it can mean for the world. And it's like, yeah, no, we can't make film. It's like, ugh, shoot, right? Trev, we can't make that movie. And right when I was feeling like just really low, I think he was taunting me a bit. He says, "But you know what we can do? You know what we can make?" And there was a pause where I leaned in. He said, "We could make a limited series designed for streaming." I'm like, "Yeah, dude, I don't know what that means. What does that mean?" He says, "Well, people aren't going to the theater to see indie drama films anymore, but they are watching Netflix and Prime and Hulu and Apple TV at home like never before. The world has changed. People will now sit down and scroll through Netflix and pass on a movie because it's an hour and a half long. People don't want to commit that kind of time to a movie. But those same people will binge like 3 55-minute episodes of Stranger Things without a second thought about it." So what if we took Paula's story, Sean explained, this beautiful, sacred story with all of its twists and turns and power and potential and substance, and rather than make it into an hour and a half movie, what if we turned it into 6 or 8 42-minute episodes? And I'm sitting there doing the math, right? Like I'm not a math guy, but 6 times 42 is more than an hour and a half. And all of a sudden, the traditional form of a movie just seemed kind of boring, seemed really flat. A limited series for streaming is instantly more Paula for more people with way more possibility. It's like, yes, let's do that. because this sacred story needs to be told. And the best part, the sacred isn't going to change. Paula's story still gets out, and the substance hasn't changed. The character, the plot, the impact is still there. The only thing that's changed is the form, the container. We were going to use a movie to point people to the story and impact people's lives, but now we're going to use a streaming limited series. We started off with the plan, let's make a movie, but real life demanded a pivot because the movie form was no longer the right option. It's not where people are at. And if Paula's story matters, if it is going to impact the world, the form has to be reimagined. Worship. I spent the first 15 years of my life as a minister in a different Christian denomination. I left it in 2015 because of the story that was being told, the ideas about God that were being held out as sacred were damaging. God was angry. God was homophobic, transphobic. God was a supremacist, anti anyone who didn't fit a very narrow mold. And the substance of a story like that, like the plot, the impact, frankly, was harmful to people's lives. So Marisol and I had to walk away. I've come to the United Church, friends, with so much prayer and reflection. I didn't just jump in. I've spent 5 years questioning. And there were many days, like so many days, maybe even most days, where I actually wanted to walk away from church altogether. And I've chosen to submerse myself in the United Church. Not because of my parents, they're Roman Catholic. Not because of my education, that's eclectic. I chose the United Church. I came to the United Church because I believe the God that is proclaimed here, the Christ that is declared here, is sacred. A God who is so generous and creative and inclusive and loving that everyone belongs, that all are welcome. Right? This is a story I want to tell with my life, a vision of God that is so big. There's only love in this God. I mean, that's truly sacred. And the substance of the United Church, the intersectionality of justice and worship, a plot where all people are invited to the table. That's a story that has impact. That's a community I want my kids to be formed in. That's a gospel I pray will continually transform us as a family. I came to the United Church because of the vision of God that is held out as sacred. Friends, like, it's not like this everywhere. And the substance of the faith of a loving God who is only ever for you is a gospel that I want to be immersed in, and it's a gospel that our world needs. And what dabbling in film is teaching me is that what really matters is the sacred. What really matters is the substance. What really matters is the beautiful vision of God we hold out for the world and the gospel we proclaim that all people belong. That's our story. That's why we do this thing called church. That's the impact we're seeking to make, right? Right? So here's the thing. If the world has changed so significantly just in the last 18 months that theaters are closing down and the film industry isn't even sure what a movie should look like anymore. So they pivot, then try another form. Is it possible that we as a church have to find new forms in this ever-emerging world so we can keep telling the sacred story of Christ? The sacred. The thing that we hold out because it's so beautiful the world needs to see it. The substance. This is how that thing, that sacred thing, impacts and changes people's lives. And the form. I mean, the form is the container we employ. The form is the mediums we choose. The form is the traditions we build in order to hold out the sacred and bring deep transformation. The form is never meant to be the sacred. The form can't be the thing that is sacred. The form points to the sacred, but it never has the substance of the sacred. You with me? The form is the delivery. The form is inviting people into the impact and the transformation that's possible. But sometimes what churches will do, what churches will confuse, is they will take a form that has been meaningful and helpful, a form that maybe has nostalgia or sentiment, all really great things, but they will enshrine or baptize the form as the thing that is sacred. So there are churches that won't sing any music unless it's played on an organ and was written before the 19th century, right? The music has been enshrined as the sacred thing. And it makes you scratch your head because in like a Me Too, Black Lives Matter, Every Child Matters, Love is Love, multicultural, social media savvy, cosmopolitan context like Toronto, trusting the divine sacred story to a form written hundreds of years ago by dead white guys in Europe might not be our best shot at communicating how beautiful this gospel is in 2021. The Bible has a word for when people, the people of God, confuse the form of their worship for the sacred which should be worshipped. When we confuse the form for the sacred, you know what that's called? It's called idolatry. So Psalm 96 starts off, sing to the Lord a new song. Like, don't be afraid to do it differently. Try something new. Sing to the Lord a new song. Don't get so enamored, enmeshed in the way that it's always been done, in the songs, in the music, in the forms, in the traditions as they've always been, that you aren't afraid to sing a new song. I'm so grateful that I found the United Church. And I don't know if I've said it. I think I have, but I'm so grateful to be here at Humber Valley. Because the vision of Christ is so beautiful and compelling, it inspires me every single day. And I'm convinced, I mean, I'm here because I'm convinced that Christ wants to inspire so many more lives through our community of faith. And together with Christ, we get to write our future. So may we take courage to write that future in forms and with enough imagination that the sacred love of Christ is shared in ways that people can hear. Because surely, if there's any story that's worth our pivot, it's the gospel of Jesus Christ. Sing to the Lord a new song. Sing to the Lord, all the earth. Sing to the Lord, praise God's name, proclaim salvation day after day. Declare divine glory among the nations, God's marvelous deeds among all peoples. for great is the Lord and most worthy of praise. Amen. Will you join me in praying as the Lord taught us to pray? Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. And this is the part of the morning where we invite you to consider contributing to the life, the work, the ministry of Humber Valley United Church by making a financial donation. You can do so online at hvuc.ca, or you can contact the church office and we can even arrange to pick up a donation from your house if you're not able to get out. Thank you so much for all you do to keep the work of Humber Valley going. Peace to you. Bless you. So friends, as we go, may we never lose sight of the sacred love of God. May we always have the imagination to share it with those we meet with creativity and humility. And may we always have the courage to recognize the form, the traditions, the containers we use must always point beyond themselves to Christ. For Christ is our hope. Amen.
Oh, there's a river that winds on forever. I'm gonna see where it leads. Oh, there's a mountain that no man has mounted. I'm gonna stand on the peak. Out there's a land that time don't command. Wanna be the first to arrive. No time for pondering why I'm wandering on while we both sit back. To the ends of the earth, would you follow me?